Good afternoon and welcome to the Fusarium webinar presented today by Dr Len Tesoriero. This webinar is part of the Soil Wealth Integrated Crop Protection and Soil-Borne Disease projects, and it's the fourth webinar in the series around disease. The other ones were on Pythium, another one on Sclerotinia, and a third one on nutrition and disease, and those recordings are available on the Soil Wealth Integrated Crop Protection website. Just Google Soil Wealth and you'll see that there. So I'd like to just acknowledge the funding for those three projects, Soil Wealth, Nutrition and Soil-Borne Disease, funded by the Vegetable Levy with matching funds from the Australian Government and managed by Hort Innovation. This session is being recorded. And the recording, along with the presentation, will be available after the webinar this afternoon. And the link to that will be sent out to all the people that are registered on the webinar. In relation to questions, please type in your questions as we go. I can see them here on the screen, and I'll put them to Len at the appropriate time in the during the webinar. So don't wait till the end. Just type them in as you think of them, and I'll try to sort of put those to him when it seems like the right time. So that's about all by way of introduction, and except to introduce Len, Len Tesoriero, who has at least 30 years' experience in vegetable plant pathology, and many of you will know Len. And many of you will have sent samples to Len over the years for identification of vegetable diseases. And he's very experienced and a wealth of knowledge in relation to that. And specifically in relation to Fusarium, Len actually did his PhD on Fusarium. So we have the right person talking to us this afternoon. So over to Len.
Thanks, Gordon. And hello, everybody. Just as a way of an overview of what we'll cover today, Gordon mentioned that I've done my PhD on Fusarium, and I have to say it's a very broad topic. It's a very complex one, and I still see myself as a bit of a student, so there's plenty of things still to learn. I thought we'll start with just a bit of background as to what it is. It's a fungus, obviously, but a little bit about it, understanding its biology and how it kind of fits into the world of plant pathogens. We'll talk a little bit about some of the diseases that Fusarium species can cause on vegetable crops. Most of you will be pretty familiar with some of them, but you'd be amazed at how many different diseases there are when you look at the spectrum of different vegetables. We'll talk about the favourable conditions that that you can have for some of the Fusarium diseases and how they spread. And finally, we'll get into some of the management options, and I've used the term integrated because, as most of you all know, it's one of those difficult soil-borne pathogens that don't easily respond to simple treatments like chemicals. So, yes, it's a soil-borne pathogen. There are many different species. Most really are just benign saprophytes. And there's a few that sort of pop up as important plant pathogens. So really there's a big ocean of Fusaria in the soils generally, different species, sometimes many strains of things like Fusarium oxysporum. And only a few of them are really the ones that cause major soil-borne diseases. They're necrotrophs, so that means that they feed on dead tissue, and that strategy that these particular types of pathogens use is they produce enzymes and toxins that kill cells as they invade them. So they're very good at managing to get into plants. They have to negotiate the rhizosphere in particular, that region around the roots, where there's commonly called a zoo of different microbes. They are able to manage their way through that, they can produce enzymes to enter the roots, then they have to actually get into the xylem vessels, which are in the centre of the root, and there's lots of barriers there, there's lots of plant responses that they've got to negotiate. And then they, once they get into the xylem vessels, then they move up the xylem vessels and eventually cause the disease. Interestingly, there's what we call specialised strains on different hosts, and I'll show you a bit more about that as we go through, but the Fusarium that you might have attacking a cucumber is different from the one that attacks a watermelon, and the different from the one that attacks lettuce, and the different. So they're all the same species as such. It's a species complex, but effectively they've got particular genetic elements in them that enable them to be specialised on particular hosts, or at least being able to cause wilt diseases and other diseases on those particular hosts. Within that, there are races, and so when we talk about varietal resistance, so for example, in lettuces overseas, there's a new race that's just appeared that has race 4 of Fusarium wilt that's occurred in the UK that I was reading about the other day, but for which there's no resistant varieties of lettuce that can be used to control it. So we've got host specialised strains, these things called forma speciales, and we've got races. So they're the sort of particular types of subspecies. What do we know about, you know, in terms of the Fusarium in its shape of the spores? These banana-shaped spores are quite characteristic, and quite often the disease itself you'll see on roots or sometimes above ground causing kind of pink discoloration, and that's usually the structures that give rise to these things called macrocnidia, these banana-shaped spores. It also produces smaller spores and resting bodies, particularly chlamydospores they're called, which can survive for many years without the host. So there, it has several different types of structures that can cause infection, but also survive in soils for long periods of time. And there's some images of those banana-shaped spores, the macrocnidia. That central picture there is the microcnidia. They're much, much smaller. It's not always easy to tell from that they're little jelly bean shaped spores, and there's some of that pink colour that, or orangey red colour even, that the fungus when it's growing in agar, and sometimes you'll see that sporulating on stems. Some of the key diseases are wilt, and probably most of you would be familiar with wilt diseases of certain vegetable crops that you work with. And Yellow's disease, quite often the wilting problem has an associated yellowing of the leaves, so that sometimes can be the first signs of the disease, with the leaves going yellow prior to the plant starting to wilt. Not all of the wilt pathogens occur in Australia, so that's important from our biosecurity point of view, and I'll show you that in the next slide. There are other diseases though. There's stem, crown and root rots, and even fruit rots caused by some strains or a different species, Fusarium solani, and strains of that species. And then there's even a few other species such as Fusarium avenaceum that causes a dry rot in carrots and can be associated with crown rot in asparagus and the like. Damping off is another common disease that Fusarium can be associated with. Quite often, as I've kind of learned more about plant pathogens, particularly the soil-borne ones, they occur in complexes, sometimes in damping off, but also in wilting and root rot type diseases. There was some classic work done back in the 60s where in peas, the Fusarium wilt in peas and Epithium disease in peas were shown individually to cause a bit of damage each, but together they caused what we call a synergistic interaction, meaning that they were not just additive. The effect of them was able to kill the plant much more quickly. And that's also known in things like beans, and we found it in cucumbers as well, where again Pythium and Fusarium combine to cause much more important disease than individually. Here's a table, I guess, showing most of the different wilt diseases, and as I call them, those strains called forma speciales. And I did a bit of checking, but I'm not even sure whether some of them occur in Australia. So just going down the list, that one in beans, I'm not sure occurs in Australia. I don't think it does. The one in brassicas, and that also gets into a few other things like rocket and the like, is present in Australia. The one in capsicums overseas is a little bit dubious. It's sort of been reported and described, but doesn't seem to be common right across the world, just a bit in Europe. So I'm not so sure about that particular strain. You can see in cucurbits, there's lots of different ones. So that top one, cucumarinum, occurs in cucumbers. Melanus occurs in rock melons. Nivium occurs in watermelons. And then those other four there are in all those Asian melons. So some of those, for example, the Lagenaria occurred in Japan, where they'd actually grafted melons onto the bottle gourd. That's a special strain that occurs in bottle gourd, and where they'd actually tried to get around Fusarium nivium, they'd grafted onto these Lagenarias, which are the bottle gourd, as a rootstock, and found that this particular strain of Fusarium started attacking them. So even using sometimes grafted rootstocks, you can get into trouble. The one on eggplant is a curious one, because I guess my experience has always been that wilting diseases of eggplants was caused by verticillium, but more recently there's been a description of this Fusarium, and I don't know whether that occurs in Australia or not. I don't know that people have really looked. I've looked a bit for the one in lettuce. That seems to occur right around the world, but there's no real reports of it in Australia. And that's the one I mentioned, that a new race has just appeared in the UK. So that could be quite a serious threat in Australia, because it seems particularly this race 4 was getting into soilless production and greenhouse production and a lot of the leafy lettuce lines, whereas traditionally, I guess in California, head lettuce were attacked by that particular strain of Fusarium. But certainly as the industries move to more of the leafy lines, some of these newer races might become more important. Similarly, in onions, and when I say onions, I refer to the onion group. So the stuff I've looked at in Australia has really been in things like leeks and spring onions. But I've never really looked for that particular Fusarium strain here, although we do know that there are diseases such as basal plate rot occurring in Australia. So again, I don't think people have really looked for that particular Fusarium oxysporum. Definitely the strain in peas occurs in Australia, Fusarium wilt in peas. Snake beans, particularly up in the Northern Territory, that's a major issue. And spinach, we do have that strain in spinach. So I remember a few years ago when I first thought I found that, and I looked at some records, and I think back in 1977 it was recorded for the first time. So it's been known for a long time, but probably quite often overlooked.
Len, can I just make a quick comment there? Just to mention another crop that's not on the list there is tomatoes, and I know that that they're not supported by the levy, and so that's, I guess, why they're not there. But many of the vegetable growers grow tomatoes as well as the levy crops, and we also have the processing tomato industry. So
yeah,
I wonder if it's worth just a quick mention about Fusarium and tomatoes.
Well, it's probably the one that's been most studied, in fact. So again, in Australia, Fusarium wilt in tomatoes is well known. There's three known races of it, and in fact, I think race three was first found in Australia before it was found anywhere else. So yeah, it's a very serious disease and pathogen that again, breeding for resistance has been the major way we've got around it. But it's been very common, I know, up in Queensland. Tomato, particularly field tomatoes, have been infected. I guess over the last decade or so, I've seen it become a major issue in greenhouse production, in particularly in the Sydney Basin, where it seems to have spread. I remember only about one or two farms had it about a decade ago, and now just about every farm has it. So it's it is a major issue. Okay. I didn't put it in this table. This table's not complete. There's probably a few others that I've ignored there, but I tried to at least get most of the key ones.
I've just got one question from Darren, and that's about Phytophthora. And I think the question is there, you mentioned the sort of complexes between different pathogens there. Can this be a complex with Phytophthora?
Yes, the answer is yes. In spinach, I found four different pathogens all working together. Excuse me. So Phytophthora, Pythium, Fusarium, and Rhizoctonia. So in many cases, you can get one of them will come in and the others will follow, or they'll all come in together under suboptimal growing conditions. So Phytophthora obviously can be a key pathogen on its own in some crops. Mm-hmm. And I mentioned right at the beginning there when I was talking about some of the, diseases Fusarium can cause, quite a lot of the Fusaria that don't cause these sorts of wilt diseases can actually cause minor root rots, a bit like some of the Pythiums. And when you have a strong pathogen like Phytophthora on a particular plant, you can actually get a number of different pathogens like Fusarium invading and causing a lot of the feeder roots to die. Mm. So they're not traditionally known to be, major wilt like this cucumber Fusarium wilt that I'm showing here. One of the curious features you should see here is that image on the left is, you can see that kind of pale salmon-coloured sporulation at the base of the stem. So that's the masses of those macroconidia. And it's kind of different from the way this particular disease appears in the Northern Hemisphere, that we get it in Australia moving right up the stem, which is kind of abnormal. And what we found was that it actually will spread through the air. And of course, if you're handling plants, then you'll get them on your hands and move it around. But it can spread through the air. But curiously, we haven't been able to demonstrate that it actually infects above the ground. So it still needs to actually come in through the root system and come back up through the plant, rather than like a lot of the airborne pathogens that can attack plant parts. But you can see that image in the middle, how devastating Fusarium wilt can be. That's in a greenhouse in South Australia. And on the right-hand side, you can see the strands of fungus inside the xylem vessel. So they're the water conducting vessels that come up from the root system into up the stem and produce or give the plant both water and nutrients from the root and soil system. So the Fusarium, it's called a vascular wilt because it moves in those vascular system. Here's an example of Fusarium wilt in spinach, and you can see here it's actually a complex of Fusarium and Pythium and Phytophthora and Rhizoctonia in this case. So that's in a field in Western Sydney. And on the right-hand side is where I've actually had healthy plants and infected it with the Fusarium to show that it's the cause. And you can see how the older leaves are yellowing and wilting So that yellowing and wilting symptom is a very typical one for Fusarium diseases. That's the basal plate rot in the legs. So I was mentioning that the plant on the left-hand side there, you can just see that sort of browning, what we call the basal plate of the leaf, and similar in onions and spring onions and the like. Again, I'm not sure what species. There's several different Fusarium species that can give rise to that disease. As I said, there's one, a wilt disease, one which occurs overseas that's, we're not sure if it is in Australia or not. I haven't mentioned much about other Fusarium species, but Fusarium solani, which is also a very common soil-borne organism, gives rise to lots of different diseases. So you can see it here on pumpkins. On a lot of cucurbits, there's a special strain that can also give rise to like a stem rot, usually around the base of the stem. And there's a couple of other important examples that I've seen in Australia and overseas. Fusarium solani, there's a strain that gets on capsicum stems and capsicum fruit, and it can cause a lot of damage. I remember looking at a crop in a fairly high-tech greenhouse in Canada where it was basically causing a stem rot and causing the plants to wilt. So in this case, it can be aerially spread, and Fusarium solani, again, like Fusarium oxysporum, a lot of them can be benign and not do very much, but every so often there's strains of it that can cause serious diseases. So I didn't want to leave tomatoes out altogether. That's just a graphic image of how, in this case, the yellowing is so... So that's up in Stanthorpe, and it's in soil, and it's race 3 of Fusarium oxysporum former specialis lycopersici. So it's the strain that, unfortunately, someone was growing a variety that didn't have resistance to that strain. So it was coming down with the disease. And in this case, I also found a number of plants with a different disease, a bacterial disease, which, again, bacterial canker. So quite often, diseases don't just appear in isolation. They tend to, you'll find more than one problem occurring in the same field and sometimes in the same plant.
Len, just before we get into the section on control and spread, yep. Just a question on notice from Peter. Yep. And Peter's asked how many strains of the various species are seed-borne. So I guess, in Australia, how many of those sort of strains? So perhaps when you're talking about this section, mind about strains.
Yep, well, I've kind of got to that point now. I've said there can be a contaminant of seed, and it obviously spreads in nurseries. The truth is that we're finding out more and more that it actually can be internally transmitted in some seed. And it's difficult to say how many because we're, I guess, just learning more about it. I used to always think that Fusarium was really just an external contaminant, but there's a lot more information and, I guess, better detection technology around these days to show that it can also be spread internally. So in some of the cucurbits, some of the melon seeds and things like that, it's shown to be an internally transmitted. So I'm no expert in sort of seed pathology as such, but we're now recognising that seed is a bigger risk than we used to think. And I guess that, in the past we might have just surface sterilised, we might have chlorinated the seed or something like that, hoping that we'd get rid of it. But clearly that wouldn't be enough if it's internally born. Overall, the transmission rate in seed's pretty low, but unfortunately, even if it's one in a million, it'd be hard to detect, but it would be something that could then spread in a nursery environment and certainly in the field. As I said earlier, it survives for many years in soils, on farms, and it's difficult to eradicate. There's a number of things around that. I mentioned those chlamydospores, those resting spores that form, and they can survive for a long period of time. But there's been a lot of other information that's come to light, and even some that I found where I was looking at Fusarium wilting cucumbers, and actually I could infect tomatoes with that particular strain. Now, it doesn't cause the disease in tomatoes, but I could actually show that the Fusarium would move into the roots and up the stem about 10 centimetres. No disease symptoms, but it showed that it could almost act as an alternative host for it. And that's been shown now for a lot of the different Forma specialis, that where they thought they were restricted in their host range, they're restricted in terms of what disease symptoms they can reproduce, but quite often they can actually be harboured by other plants. So things like crop rotation, that would have sort of been one of the key things for management, may not work as well as what we would have thought they would, because of not just their survival in soil for long periods, but the fact that they can actually live in other hosts.
Len, can I just bring you back to that issue of seed-borne again? And I think I might have just misread that question. I think that the question is actually, Peter, from Peter, is how many of the non-Australian strains across the various crop species are seed-borne? So I guess the question is, are there any sort of threats out there things we don't have yet we could get as seed-borne?
Well, that is the potential. I mean, the truth is I don't know, but the more we're learning, the more we're recognising these are biosecurity risks, and that's why, I went out looking, for example, for those strains that occur in the Asian melons. Now, I didn't find any in Australia, whereas I know that when I've done some work in Asia, they're very common, you know, in bitter melons and things like that. But in Australia, I didn't find them. But then again, that's just me going out looking. So they're potentially here, and they could potentially come in with seed. So it does make the whole issue of international movement of seed a little bit more of an issue. But having said that, I think good quality management systems in seed production and seed distribution are things that I guess are in the best interest of seed companies to make sure they're not spreading these things around. So. Hopefully that's why we haven't seen a number of these things in the past. Even with Fusarium wilting cucumbers, the strains in Australia are different from the ones that occur in Europe. So despite the fact that our seed has been coming in from Europe for a number of years, we don't seem to have the same strains that they have. So take that on face value. But yeah, a good question.
So Asian melons and cucumber are the main ones that you're aware of?
They're the ones I've looked at, but then there are others, like, for example, that lettuce one has also been known to be seed-borne as well. Yeah, so, again, we probably bring in lettuce seed from overseas these days. Okay, so let's keep moving. Where'd we get to? So the survival, difficult to eradicate. Spread with soil and media and water. So, you know, we talk about these things as being soil-borne pathogens, but they're also spread, as I said, that cucumber one can be spread through the air. There's another one on basil that can be spread through the air, but the infection still has to come through the root system. And sciarid flies, so probably even more than just sciarid flies, some other insects could also transmit it. So one of our students who did a PhD was able to get a beautiful image, and I couldn't find it for today's presentation, but it shows that the sciarid flies can actually, the adults can actually spread those macroconidia, those banana-shaped spores. They've got very hairy legs, and they're attracted to organic matter, and so the spores actually get stuck in their legs, in the hairs in their legs, and then they can fly around and move them around. So clearly, if it can happen with things like sciarid flies, working in the field, you can pick it up on equipment, and workers with their hands, particularly in greenhouse cropping where you're training stuff. If you're moving through a paddock or something, you can spread them around quite easily with footwear and on clothing. In terms of favoured conditions, and if you saw the talk I gave on the interaction between nutrition and diseases, ammonium nitrogen seems to be one thing that favours most of the Fusarium wilt pathogens on different crops. So avoiding ammonium nitrogen is a key for control. And there's a few others that are more specific to certain Fusarium wilt diseases. So potassium deficiency in brassicas favours that yellows disease. So it's something that there are a few specific cases where certain nutrients or deficiencies of certain nutrients can be more favourable. Calcium obviously is another big one in lots of different diseases and including in many cases Fusarium. So if you've got poor calcium levels, then Fusarium becomes more of a problem.
Is calcium sort of protective? Can we protect the plants from calcium sprays or through the trickle?
Well, it does a few things. It's integral to forming a matrix in the cell walls. It also, on its own, stimulates some of the plant defences. So it acts in a few different ways. So it's an important element that there's many, many examples of where people have shown that lower calcium levels are associated with increased disease symptoms and the like. And I guess that comes down to that final point that any plant stress, be it water, nutrition, or in many cases fruit load, high fruit loads are when a lot of these things are expressed. Fusarium wilt in tomatoes on heavily fruited crops can cause them to collapse as those fruit are draining a lot of the resources from the plant and putting stress on the plant as they're trying to fill. And then some of the pathogens, to address that point on temperature, seem to be favoured by particular temperature ranges. And in some cases, that can be quite useful in management. So you can actually use your plants, your scheduling, your planting scheduling to avoid particular ranges of temperatures where the disease might be worse. So a good example of that, I think, is in lettuces overseas. They've shown that by avoiding some of the very hot periods of the year, you can manage diseases. But it's quite true of a lot of, particularly the Fusarium wilt diseases, tend to be favoured in the warmer temperature ranges. So just avoiding those extreme temperatures is important. I've shown this image before, but that's just where we added some urea to these plants with Fusarium wilt, and it brought on Fusarium wilt. You can see the pots that I added the urea to very quickly. And in a more, I guess, greenhouse cucumber situation, we managed to reproduce the same thing. So certainly I've done most of my work in cucurbits with Fusarium wilt, but it's one of those things that can occur in, it's known to occur in a lot of those other cropping examples in vegetables. And again, the mechanisms are multifaceted. Ammonium decreases soil pH and increases amino acid exudates from roots. So it influences the rhizosphere bacteria and other organisms. It seems to stimulate the germination of Fusarium, so both Fusarium solanum and Fusarium oxysporum. It seems that in some cases to increase the virulence of Fusarium oxysporum in some of the work. And then there's this weird interaction where it represses uptake of nitrates and potassium and stimulates chloride uptake. So there's this sweet spot that's known to be about 3.5 of the potassium to chloride ratio. So if you move away from that, it seems to be more conducive for Fusarium wilt disease. So that bit of work was done some time ago. I don't know if it's sort of valid. It's been published, but something I've never followed up to validate myself.
Len, I've got a question on watermelons. Can we?
Yeah, we can.
Do you want to do that now, or do you want to have that later on?
What's the question?
Okay. The question is, Len, do you have any confirmation of FON, which I guess is Fusarium oxysporum nidivium?
Yep.
In watermelon crops grown in North Queensland, it tends to be vine collapse / wilt with watermelon crops grown on ex-sugar cane ground. Yeah. Not sure if Fusarium oxysporum nidivium or something else such as pythium, possibly.
Okay, yeah. So this...
That's from Justin. Thank you, Justin.
Okay. Yeah, tricky question. there's a few different issues in watermelons, and this vine decline problem seems not always... Well, actually, most of the time doesn't seem to be a Fusarium oxysporum problem. Now, I haven't studied it extensively, but I've done quite a bit of diagnostics and found that there are other things that seem to be associated with this vine decline, particularly of maturing crops. So when you've got a full sort of a composite of fruit that are getting close to maturity, stress on the plant, and we're actually finding more commonly other pathogens, and the same occurs in rock melons too. And I've more often than not found that there's other soil-borne fungi like Macrophemina and the gummy stem blight fungus associated with these things. Overseas, there's other fungi again that we don't have here, and I've actually looked for those some of those other pathogens and not found them. So I found another one that curiously used to be called a Fusarium, which is now known not to be a Fusarium, but in southern Europe is shown to be associated with vine decline. So it's one of those areas where we really need more research in Australia because we don't really know all the answers. But to answer the question, FON, the Fusarium oxysporum nidivium, which is the Fusarium wilt of watermelons, is not commonly associated with the vine decline problem. It's a separate issue. So I've probably already mentioned a lot of these things in terms of management, but we'll go through them now. Clearly, and you know, most growers would already be aware that resistant varieties are the key for being able to control Fusarium wilt diseases. And so that's been a huge effort in seed company breeding programs over the years, is to identify resistant genes, and developing varieties around those. The big problem is that new races emerge. So as I mentioned with tomatoes, we've got, you know, race one, then race two, and then race three's turned up. I think we're starting to get tomato varieties in Australia that now have resistance to race three and still have all the good attributes. But where that hasn't quite caught up, grafting onto resistant rootstocks is a pretty important one. And that's certainly the case for cucumbers, where we've found that grafting onto resistant cucumber varieties or onto pumpkin rootstocks, we've been able to control Fusarium wilt. And of course in watermelons that's commonly used as well. Avoiding the ammonium fertiliser is key, and I've already talked about that. So using nitrate forms of nitrogen in preference. Watering, and so I did mention things like plant stresses, so overwatering, using less more often. I quite often see farmers who will particularly in some of the intensive veggie production, will be clearly overwatering their vegetables. So that imposes a number of stresses and favours not just Fusarium but all the soil-borne pathogens. Certainly preventative measures both in farms and in protected cropping are critical. The cotton industry, where they had problems with Fusarium, adopted this Come Clean, Go Clean. And I know from the biosecurity standpoint, Ausveg have done a lot of work in Australia to promote similar messages for vegetable growers. I think we've still got a long way to go in that respect, in making sure that we're not spreading diseases and pathogens such as Fusarium around. Controlling sciarid flies and other soil-borne insects. So remembering that Fusarium can actually get into healthy roots, but any injury to those roots make it a lot easier. So getting across that ecological zoo in that region around the root system is a lot easier if the roots are damaged, or as I mentioned earlier, if some of the nutrition's wrong and the roots are more leaky. Removing or burying plant trash or plant wastes is critical, and so that's one where we're trying to hasten the breakdown of organic matter, which can harbour all those Fusarium spores, because Fusarium can survive quite happily as a saprophyte and proliferate on decaying organic matter. So those spores that you saw earlier can form quite readily on decaying material. So you need to get that material either removed or buried and decomposing. And that comes down to, I mentioned crop rotation as being largely ineffective. Sometimes there's not a lot you can do, but there probably are some rotations that are better than others. Using certain cover crops, there's work done, and a lot of people would be aware of the biofumigant crops that are available these days that can actually allow the chemical release that will fumigate the soil. Various organic amendments, composted materials, are known to suppress all the different plant pathogens, including Fusarium. There's various microbial biocontrols that can be used. In particular, there's a couple of bacteria, some of the pseudomonads that can suppress Fusarium, and some of the trichodermas can parasitize the Fusarium fungus. Plant defense activators, things like silica, soluble silica, are known to stimulate the plant defense. There's a few others. As I said, calcium itself can act as a plant defense activator. Chemical registrations are few and far between, other than just basically going with fumigation. And even fumigation can give short-term relief, but of course it's very hard, particularly in soils. Fumigants will only work to a certain depth, and Fusarium can go down a lot further than the fumigant can, so it can actually grow back again. So very similar to what I talked about when we spoke about Pythium. Fumigation is a last resort, but can be effective, but short-term it can be effective without long-term relief. Here's just a couple of images I thought I'd show. These are in protected cropping, and you can see here some of the practices that make me tear my hair out sometimes. So you can see on the left there, preparing media right next to the crop. You can see seedlings on the right-hand side growing right next to the crop as well. So segregating those, and you can see there's not much hygiene. You've got bare floor all around the place there. Even with a bit of plastic, it's exposed to the elements. So poor hygiene in terms of seedling production. Over in these two slides, you can see in particular crop removal of wastes and and dropping the leaves on the ground, all favouring the saprophytic growth of Fusarium. So, in those sorts of situations, getting them in a bin and getting them straight out would be the way to go. So let's just conclude. I guess it's true to say that most vegetable crops have some sort of Fusarium disease. I listed most of the Fusarium wilt diseases there. I talked a little bit about some of the others, that the Fusarium solani in particular, that can cause, in some cases, a crown rot or a stem rot, or in some that case I showed with the pumpkins, a fruit rot. So it seems that most of the veggies, if not some of those more serious diseases, can be affected by some of the minor diseases, just slight root rotting that I mentioned some of these other strains can do. From a biosecurity point of view, I think we're pretty exposed. I don't think many people have looked for Fusarium wilt in eggplants. I don't know that anyone really looks for Fusarium wilt in lettuces. And there's a few others there that I mentioned that we're not sure about. The one in the leeks, whether it's here or not, don't really know. It's difficult to manage because it becomes endemic on your farm, and so because it can survive for long periods of time in soil, it can keep coming back into your crop despite whatever else you do. Most of the chemical controls are ineffective, so there's nothing really that I know of that's registered. I guess in the old days we had the benzimidazole, the benlate type fungicides that could be used, but they're all off the market now and there's really nothing that's completely effective. Some of the chemicals in some of the fungicides may have some effectiveness, but they're probably, they're certainly not registered for Fusarium control. Some of the azoxystrobin and things like that probably have some activity against Fusarium, but as I said, they're not generally registered for control of Fusarium. So it really comes down to integrated management, using that more holistic approach, looking at prevention from the point of view of seedling production, making sure the seedlings are healthy, right through to the way your cultural controls and all the other things I've mentioned sort of combined together without any really straight, simple answer. So I might finish it there. Again, not an easy topic to give you lots of positive information about, but hopefully something that over time, particularly resistant varieties, understanding which strain you have is probably pretty important, which race you have, all very important in terms of knowing how to manage them.
Thanks, Len. We do have a few questions, so I'll start with those, if that's okay. Another question from Darren. What about the use of potassium phosphite as a control tool?
Okay, so phosphite is a general plant defence activator, so it doesn't have any specific fungicidal activity against Fusarium, but it would help to stimulate some of the plant defences. Now, whether or not it would be effective against Fusarium, I'm not really sure. There's various pathways that are stimulated by the different plant defence activators, and so whether you'd expect in this case the same sort of pathway to be stimulated, I'm not really sure, but it probably, because there's what they call crosstalk between the different defence pathways, it probably would help a little bit, but again, it wouldn't be a panacea. It might be helpful.
Okay. We talked a bit about seed transmission before. What can growers do to reduce the risk of seed transmission?
That's a good question. It really comes back to being, having a good relationship with the seed company that's supplying you, and hopefully with their quality management systems that they'll be able to give you some sort of assurance that their seed is being tested and shown to be free. In the past we would have used things like hot water treatment on lots of different seeds. That's sort of not so much used these days, mostly because of fear of loss of germination, and a lot of the hybrid seed in particular is quite expensive, so it becomes a bit of an issue. I mentioned things like surface sterilising with things like hyperchlorite, but it's not going to help in terms of internal infection. So, again, no easy answer.
Okay, just another one. In relation, so we've got seed transmission. We've talked about this, the crops that the species or the former species that we have and the strains and so on. What do we know in the broader sort of picture? What do we know about the, you know, the occurrence of Fusarium strains by crops? Do we have a good understanding of what we have at this stage or not?
Well, as I said, there's certain ones that we know we have, and even then, as we've kind of done more study on them, like the cucumber one, for example, I was able to show that it's similar to the ones that occur overseas, but it's also unique. So I don't want to go right into the genetics of it, because in the last decade there's been a lot more knowledge of how what we call the particular genes that are important for host specificity we're starting to work out where they are in the genome, and the fact is that they can move around from what we call lateral or horizontal transfer, and that kind of complicates the whole issue with Fusarium genetics and our understanding of what a forma specialis is and the like. So it's a basically a topic unto itself. But one of the messages I'd like from today is that there's probably examples of where we don't know, or we're not known, we don't know that some of the former specialis are in Australia or not. And that is something I think the industry should be, a bit more proactive in terms of surveillance and doing some of the work that can confirm which ones we have and which ones we don't.
Yep.
And that can help then direct both the industry in general to what to be more aware of in terms of whether we're kind of happy that we don't have something, then we do take more preventative measures and making sure they don't come in.
Okay, thanks, Lynn. Now there's another question from Maria. Thanks, Maria. Is there a pre-plant test? Can we find out, do we have Fusarium in our soil or not? Is there some sort of test that we can use? And if so, where do we get it?
Yeah, it's a good question. And unfortunately, as I mentioned, particularly with Fusarium oxysporum, they're all very similar. Even genetically, you can have a non-pathogenic Fusarium oxysporum, which is very similar to a pathogenic one. Some tests have been developed, but having said that, they're not always validated, and in fact sometimes when some of the validation work has been done, it's shown that they can also pick up other things. So we still have a way to go there. There's some of that genetic work I mentioned before briefly about the host specific genes maybe leading to better genetic probes for the particular strains that are can attack a certain crop or not. But even then, I read a paper from California just recently. No, it was from Florida. And they looked at in tomatoes, the Fusarium strains in tomatoes, and they didn't get a good correlation between the ones that they thought were going to be race 3 and some of the genetic tests that they were doing. So. You know, I think we're getting closer to it, but we're not there yet. And unfortunately, particularly in field situations, Fusarium oxysporum is very common in the soil.
Mm.
So you'll always get a positive test for the species level.
Mm.
It's that subspecies delineation that makes it a lot harder.
Mm.
And even then, it's sometimes difficult to distinguish between a pathogenic strain and a non-pathogenic strain.
Mm. So something for the future?
Something for the future. And unfortunately, at the moment, the only easy way, particularly when I talk about races, at the moment, virtually all of them need to be basically tested against a panel of known varieties with specific resistance to the different races.
Mm.
But that's, again, something that technology is moving pretty rapidly, and what we call marker genes are now being determined to at least help breeders in getting to know which resistant genes are in the plant.
Mm.
But on the other side, it's still quite often down to a test, okay. a bioassay.
So where can people send? So if you've got an affected plant, where can people send that?
There's diagnostic centres all around the country, so it depends on where you are and who you want to use. So there's clearly, virtually each state government have their own diagnostic service.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. Well, thank you, Len. I think we're just about out of time and we have no further questions. So I'd like to thank everyone for attending the webinar today. I hope you found it useful. We've had a couple of comments already back in the on the questions thanking you for a very good presentation. So thank you, Len, for that. Apologies for changing the date from last week. We couldn't really agree about that. So apologies for that. A reminder that the webinar is being recorded, and that recording will be made available later today or tomorrow, and we'll send that link out to you. And also, along with that link, you'll be able to download the PowerPoint presentation along with that. I'd like to acknowledge the support from the Vegetable Levy for the three projects that are involved in presenting this at Soil Wealth, Integrated Crop Protection and Soilborne Disease Project. Also, the matching funds from the Australian Government and the support from Hort Innovation, who manage those projects. And also, thanks to AusVeg, who are always very supportive in these sorts of things and help us with promoting these webinars and other things. So thanks to AusVeg as well. Please have a great Christmas, and talk to you hopefully in the new year. Thank you.
Thank you.